man, Manhattan's getting way too expensive. New York's too pricey, too busy. Let's go back home. Let's go back to a nice, quiet city. Go back to San Francisco. My grandma still lives there somewhere. You know, nice, quiet, laid back. Save a little money, right? Let's check out what we can get. San Francisco. Holy shit.
Anywhere that you tell me to. If you need me to be with you, I will follow. Oh, where you lead, I will follow.
San Francisco, that old beautiful port city, rich with history, that somehow wound up all the way on the Pacific coast. This is famously the city that Jefferson Starship built in 1985. But more accurately, this was the fort and mission that Junipero Serra's Franciscan missionaries built in 1776, when the Spanish military wanted to get control of California before the other colonial powers could get to it. It was a distant frontier post when the United States captured it in the Mexican-American War in 1848. But later that year, James Marshall found some gold flakes by a sawmill, and suddenly the city exploded, with people from all over the world wanting to get at California's gold. 2 years later, California was a fully-fledged state, and San Francisco went from a 1,000-person outpost to 25,000 residents, not even counting the constant flow of people passing through to the gold fields. For the next 100 years, San Francisco kept growing massively in size and importance, from being the Gold Rush's port to the shipyards for the Pacific Theater of World War II and the home of the 60s counterculture, quickly building itself to be the fifth densest county in the U.S. today, only behind four of the five boroughs of New York. Let's start out by taking a look at San Francisco's urban layout for a second, because it is truly fantastic. Let's just take a look at how long it takes from downtown before we reach an obstruction or a dead zone neighborhood or some sort of dead end, alright? We'll start at the ferry building, which still has ferries running to it, still an active building. Next thing you know, we've got downtown coming out of it, you know, a lot of nice skyscrapers, buildings. You've got the Transamerica Pyramid, the Bank of America building, famous skyline. And now you're thinking, okay, we're going to hit some parking lots and some highway on-ramps, and that'll be it. That'll be Central Business District, end of the story. Instead, San Francisco put Union Square. They put a finely manicured, really ritzy park and surrounded it by like the Grand Hyatt and the Marriott, all these big hotels. And that's left just enough space for basically a Fifth Avenue style high-end shopping district right by downtown. You know, if you work downtown, you could stop by, buy a new suit, buy some jewelry and stuff. And we've expanded the city out this far. And it's a short walk over to the next series of attractions like Japantown, where you can get really great manju over here at Benkudo's, and a lot of great restaurants and, you know, cultural attractions like the Peace Pagoda. And once you've reached this area in between here, you see Highway 101, which isn't an expressway. They've basically just have had 101 go through Lombard Street and Van Ness Avenue, which has crossings and turns at every block, just like a normal street. What that means is the commuters going to and from the Golden Gate Bridge here can turn off at any street to go to a favorite restaurant or coffee shop in the morning or on the way back. So one street away from Lombard or Van Ness is basically a bustling restaurant and commercial street the entire length, because of the options that all these turns provide the commuters going along Highway 101. And from there, you've got a couple of parks that help anchor these neighborhoods farther out, where they're more residential, but they still have, you know, mixed-use development interspersed with them. They can be quieter while still having the convenience and amenities of a city, and still being fully connected to downtown. Basically, what this layout's done is it's made no obstructions at all from downtown all along the coast, all the way really until we hit Park Presidio Boulevard or Twin Peaks. And the only reason Twin Peaks gets in the way is because of sheer geography. You physically can't build over it. San Francisco's used up basically all the land that it's been given. And even the areas that have been cut off, like the Richmond District or the Sunset District, are still anchored by things like Ocean Beach and Golden Gate Park, and they're big enough to be able to be self-contained, sort of as their own boroughs. They've got their own commercial streets, their own small blocks, and some mixed-use or mixed-use-able zoning to be able to survive in sort of like a Brooklyn-esque style. And a great example of this is actually the Mission District and Dolores Heights and the Castro. It's also a big enough district to function sort of as its own borough, and it's perfectly interconnected up in this northern part here to make it one of the most popular regions in the world today. Mark Zuckerberg's got a house out here in the Mission District somewhere. What they've done is they have Castro Street, center of the Castro District, famous center of the gay rights movement in the 20th century, and it's a pretty popular and bustling, you know, commercial street. But three blocks away, you've got Mission Dolores Park, which centers the residential area. You've got some commercial activity around it. It's a place where people want to go, especially in San Francisco's weather. And two blocks away from that, the Mission District suddenly clumps its blocks together a lot closer together. It looks like downtown Lisbon with all these narrow corridors of blocks. But this ups the density of the Mission District. More people in this specific area means that Mission Street and Valencia Street in this part are the perfect place to make a commercial center of the Mission District. You can see all these restaurants and bars that are just a few blocks away from the park, a few blocks away from the restaurants and bars and shops in the Castro. There's no lull in between this entire stretch. It's all different styles of where people want to walk in between and where people want to go. And that helps to anchor this entire area as one of the most sought after and desired neighborhoods today. Now, another way that San Francisco is really doing a fantastic job in urban planning is taking advantage of its natural geography. Part of that is being built along a mountain range. San Francisco's got some of the most wild fucking hills you've ever seen. I mean, look at this. That's a workout if I ever saw one. But what they've done is used it to basically make the entire range of urban life all in a very short area in some of these districts. Just look at Telegraph Hill and Russian Hill. You know, you would think Columbus Avenue and this diagonal in the middle would sort of be the weird borderlands in between them. But instead, it's the confluence. It's the downtown bustling commercial center of both of these neighborhoods. Part of that's because Columbus Avenue is a diagonal road. You sort of can't miss it. It's the one with the weird triangular blocks, and it goes between the Transamerica Pyramid downtown and Fisherman's Wharf. So being at the bottom of the hill from these two neighborhoods, add that in, and it's the perfect place for everyone to go to a restaurant or a bar or a shop. And if this really bustling and, you know, high-powered city commercial life isn't for you, just go a couple blocks away up the hill. People don't want to go all the way up a hill to go to a restaurant or a shop. But these residential neighborhoods are anchored by non-commercial attractions like Coit Tower over on Telegraph Hill, or Lombard Street, the famous windy street over on Russian Hill. These bring in attraction and foot traffic from the commercial centers, making this entire area constantly moving with people going back and forth all throughout, while still providing the full range of different urban life. Just go a couple blocks away and you've got historic mansions and great views, or hip restaurants and easy access to downtown or the coast. It's not like that these are all separate areas. It's all one interconnected city, and yet it still has a wide diversity of choice for the people living and walking around in it. Now, another great thing that San Francisco has done is it's basically turned its coast into a massive attraction instead of, you know, a weird dead end with Marlon Brando movies and whatnot. Just start down at AT&T Park. You've got all the bars and restaurants for ballpark goers. And then you can cross the street here to actually see the water. Next thing you know, you've got Lincoln Park. Okay, that's a little racist, I'm sorry. And you've got the ferry building with a lot of shops and a farmer's market on Saturdays. The Embarcadero lined with palm trees all along the water. And then you can get to Pier 39, where you can see the seals at the end, shops, restaurants, and you got the aquarium you could check out. You've got Fisherman's Wharf right next to it. And from there, you've got the parks and the marinas along the Marina District. You've got the Palace of Fine Arts, the Presidio. And the Presidio's got the Golden Gate Bridge. And if you want to get a really good view of the Golden Gate Bridge, you just go to Baker Beach or China Beach. And then you've got the Legion of Honor and the Cliff House with the camera obscura and the weird laughing lady that's creepy as hell. And from there, you've got Ocean Beach, which anchors the Richmond District and the Sunset District all the way down to the zoo, which is on the beach. And from there, you've run out of San Francisco. This entire coast where the people live is an attraction. It's not just the farthest places from downtown. It's an attraction in its own right that you want to live near and want to go to. That's a massive contrast from Manhattan, where they tell me it's an island, but you wouldn't know it from living there. You've got the coast all along the rivers is train depots, warehouses, cliffs, an expressway on Harlem River Drive, and that continues along. You've got projects that really are the only places that have views of the river. They don't even have buildings or businesses or anything or offices that you can see the river. From there, you got a Target in the way. It turns into FDR Drive, more projects. The only break is really Gracie Mansion, where the mayor lives. The UN building, where you basically need to go through a full pat-down and be a diplomat just to get to the place where you can see the water. And then it's a lot more projects under the bridge, old industrial buildings, until Battery Park is really the only place you can see the water. And that's only a way to see the water because the bridge they were trying to build over here had to be turned into a tunnel so they didn't demolish this 300-year-old fortress. Otherwise, they would have covered that up too. And Battery Park City is only accessible because it was all the land they took out for the foundations for the World Trade Center, and they had already built the highway, so they put it on the other side. Otherwise, that wouldn't have been there. And from there, there's sort of like a nice jogging trail, but you have to cross West Street, which functions as a highway, and you have to go through all this way before you can even see that there's a river here. Otherwise, there are sporadic redeveloped piers, but they're few and far between until West End Drive basically just turns back into a highway, completely blocking your view all the way up until we get up to Inwood and back out again to the Bronx, while only having seen the water twice? If you include Gracie Mansion? It is remarkably easy to forget that there is actually water around Manhattan, because they don't let you see it. But the problem isn't its layout. It's that no one can afford to live there. Thanks in part to the tech boom, San Francisco currently has the highest housing prices in the nation, with median home prices hitting $1.6 million, nearly doubling since just 2013. One of the consequences of this is the nation's third largest per capita homelessness rate. Despite the city spending $450,000 a day in assistance, around 7,000 people are estimated to be living on San Francisco's streets, 71% of which had housing in the city before becoming homeless. As tech industry giants like Twitter and Salesforce move into the city, thousands of high-paying tech jobs are competing for every available bit of housing. This has turned the Bay Area's housing market almost exactly backwards. Only the highest paid, most senior tech employees can really afford to live in the city itself, where they trade the Bay Area's worsening commutes for a high-density, homeless-filled, old housing stock existence no one else with their incomes would stand for. Meanwhile, service workers and working-class people who would most benefit from the convenience of high-density life, the 24-hour amenities, transportation to fit odd job hours, they're instead forced out into some of the farthest corners and longest commutes of the metropolitan area. A popular solution has been to build affordable housing units, but that barely makes a dent in this big number of people who can't afford the city they call home. The New York Times recently reported on a new development offering 95 affordable apartments that got 6,580 applications. It's not that the people can't afford the city, it's that the city simply can't be afforded, period. San Francisco's a gold rush city again, and there's barely enough apartments on this peninsula for the tech millionaires, and they're getting them all. The current housing stock from the 50s just isn't enough. The truth is, at some point, at least part of these low-lying buildings and neighborhoods are going to have to be replaced with much higher density housing to be able to even come close to solving these mounting problems. But you can't just pave over San Francisco. This city is unique and a beautiful phenomenon that you just don't see anywhere else. Just look at literally almost any block in the city, and because of the small parcel sizes, you'll see an amazing amount of diversity and creativity in the different houses built, all right next to each other. The majority of these houses are the ornate Victorian houses that San Francisco's famous for, but no two are truly alike, and they're all painted interesting colors like pink, green, red, blue, yellow. And the low-rise, tree-heavy approach to a lot of San Francisco's blocks make it the architectural capital of the historical style of development that characterizes the entire California coast. Cities like Monterey, Santa Cruz, Carmel by the Sea all spread low and broad from under the eucalyptus trees. It's got this distinctive look created by the first major wave of U.S. settlement in the post-war years. When you see a California city, you know it's a California city. No other place in the world looks quite like it. And San Francisco is that cultural and spiritual capital of that historical development. And even after the ancient history here, San Francisco's made history of its own almost every decade since. And these are the same streets that Jefferson Airplane, the Grateful Dead, Huey Lewis and the News walked down to get their first gigs. These are the hills that Steve McQueen and Clint Eastwood tore their cars down trying to catch the bad guys. Almost every neighborhood in the city has been immortalized in either film, TV, or national history. In the Castro District, there's one of the center points of the gay rights movement going back decades. Harvey Milk's camera shop is on Castro Street. See, you can't just bulldoze these blocks down and still call it San Francisco. But we can't ignore the plight of a crippling homelessness crisis and rents rising to be higher than any other city in the nation. But how can we possibly do both? How do we preserve the irreplaceable history of San Francisco without destroying the dynamism that created that history? Well, Scott Byers, a journalist and columnist that's been studying this sort of thing for years, and in a couple of articles for Forbes, he's made a case that San Francisco's solution is already underway. In Miami. See, Miami's faced the same dilemma as San Francisco as the financial sector began moving away from the highly taxed Northeast and looking towards Latin America, coming to Miami in waves. This is all well and good, except that Miami's historic, low-rise, sprawling Cuban immigrant neighborhood of Little Havana is literally right outside of downtown. This area's been the heart of Cuban American culture ever since exiles began fleeing Cuba following Castro's takeover in 1959, and it still celebrates a unique Cuban heritage to this day. So how has Little Havana avoided being quickly overrun and gentrified once Miami's tiny downtown got flooded with these finance jobs? Essentially, Miami realized that these high-income finance workers didn't want to live on the inland areas of a booming, trendy, coastal city, and certainly didn't want to pay through the nose to rent Little Havana's old, lower-income-built housing. So what they did was start to build high-rise apartments and offices continuing along the coast. As Miami continued to grow, this neighborhood of Brickell just kept growing skyward, not inward, until now it's basically a second downtown Miami, with all the vibrant nightlife, walkability, and premium ocean views that the new financial sector loves. As Brickell has grown, it's taken up almost all of the high-income population growth that Miami's seen in the past few decades, providing no compromises for its residents, while sparing neighborhoods like Little Havana from the disruptive and devastating effects of gentrification that would normally sweep over them. While San Francisco's historically Mexican-American Mission District is now the trendy home of Mark Zuckerberg, home prices in Little Havana are still a full 40% lower than the Miami average, well within reach of the Cuban population that's defined this neighborhood for generations. Now, it turns out San Francisco also has a stretch of waterfront land just south of downtown, and it just so happens that no one really remembers that land is there. Once you go south of the ballpark, cross China Basin, and you'll see the old industrial dockyards. These areas are largely unused, almost all the shipping moved to the East Bay years ago, and this end of town is cut off entirely by not one but two big obstructive highways, hiding it away from the rest of the city. I mean, look at it. In a city squeezed for space, you've got underutilized loading docks, open parking lots, restaurant supply warehouses, straight up empty land. The neighborhoods that are here are cut off, forced to act as an awkward inner ring suburb, only tenuously connected to the rest of the city, if at all. Now, San Francisco is going to need a bit bigger of a Burkell-type neighborhood than Miami to house all of its new tech yuppies and millionaires, but the full fifth of its city territory east of 101 that the rest of the city's forgotten about has more than enough space for even the most determined of industries. But of course, San Francisco's notoriously touchy about not messing up its skyline or blocking anyone's view of the bay or their natural sunlight or anything, and I can understand their concern with some people's plans to tear up, say, North Beach or the Embarcadero to line it with skyscrapers and yuppie monoliths. That would be ruining the parts of San Francisco, its iconic, accessible coastline, the views from its rolling hills that made it so desirable in the first place. But with the southeast part of the city, we'd be ruining exactly what view? Between 101 snaking through and Potrero Hill and 280, there's no sunlight left the block. You could literally build Manhattan here, and the southeast side would still be just as inconsequential to the rest of the city as the ocean is to the Ocean View neighborhood. And where the southeast side isn't empty or low-value industrial leftovers, it's poorly integrated city housing that's being adversely affected by artificial and natural cutoffs and boundaries. You're telling me you're going to build long stretches of under-the-highway hobo-ready spots in an already overcrowded city, run them right under these three-block-long murder bridges, and have these be the only links into a working-class-style, essentially suburban neighborhood? This part of town is already ruined. It is simply not equipped to deal with the problems that high density brings, especially once the economy stops booming. But you know it can deal with the problems of living next to a highway overpass? The private security and self-contained amenities of luxury high-rise condos. They're basically purpose-built to make luxury enclaves of these cordoned-off, exclusive areas. If you've zoned your neighborhood for Disneyland, nothing else is gonna ever fit, so put Disneyland there. As Jeb Bush once said, "Eat your heart out, Zuckerberg." But wait, you'll say, these houses are still houses, and some of these places are historically minority and working-class neighborhoods. And look, there's not gonna be a perfect consequence-free solution to fix San Francisco's or any city's housing problems. But minority and poor neighborhoods are already being swallowed up by gentrification in other parts of the city. As the cost of living rises dramatically, even if you have rent control, you'll be priced out of these places, and the few families who can still hold on will find these neighborhoods taken over and fundamentally changed no matter what they do, just from sheer demand. Either we can go through transparent practices to provide some assistance or compensation to the people who've lived here for generations, or see not only this area, but the entire city, slowly get pushed out and forgotten, with no way of finding everyone affected and providing any recourse for their hardship. Many of them are already homeless on the streets where they once lived, and this only stands to grow worse as the housing crisis builds. We can contain the housing crisis spreading across San Francisco, but it'll require repurposing the city's most underutilized land to be able to take up the slack in the least intrusive way possible. Places like Dogpatch and Hunter's Point are poised to take on the role of Burkell in relation to San Francisco's downtown. And places like the old 1939 Golden Gate International Expo Grounds on Treasure Island could be turned into San Francisco's Burkell Key, with great views and convenience, without taking housing that the tech yuppies don't want from the historic neighborhoods of the city itself. Even if you added tons of taxes and fees to the development plans, and even the development underway in the north end of this area, these buildings would still be so high value and high density that you'd still get people to pay them, and you could use that money to significantly assist current residents. And just like with Little Havana, rents in the rest of San Francisco might just get low enough that the money could keep these residents in the city after all. Maybe a bunch of runaways can once again meet up in a weird little neighborhood by Golden Gate Park and capture the imagination of an era. Or a small camera shop owner can rise up with his community to fight discrimination and social stigmas swept under the rug everywhere else. And maybe when Starfleet finally sets up its headquarters here in the 23rd century, the descendants of the 49 gold miners will still have a place in the city they've built.
The San Francisco city is good as a whole.
Dum, 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 dum,
clear. There's tech bros and hippies and blue collar folks at home.
Dum, 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 dum,
clear. We could be saving renters a ton if every city under the sun could add some
building.
What do you guys think? What would you do to solve San Francisco's housing crisis? I know that's a bit of a big question, but if you got an answer, let me know in the comments below. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. If you like this video, hit the thumbs up button on the way out. It really helps us out. And if you want to see more content like this, hit subscribe. We'll have a new video out every 2 weeks, and you won't want to miss it. Anyway, I'm Mike, and I just looked at the map.